All right. Well, thank you for anyone watching. Thank you to everyone who joined us. This is Afro-Latin Jazz Alliance Digital Village. This is our weekly masterclass series with my brother, Adam O'Farrill. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Zack O'Farrill. I'm the Director of Education Programs at ALJA. And I'm going to fade into the background in a second and let my brother take over. But yeah, this is part of all of our online programming. At the end of this, I might make a little plug for our ALJA Emergency Artist Fund that we have going to try and help support some of the many incredible musicians and artists in the New York area who are struggling during during all of this quarantining and social distancing. But we're gonna keep it light for now, and I'm gonna turn it over to my brother Adam, and let him do his thing. Adam, you got it.
Cool. Thank you, Zack. And thank you to those of you who are here. I'm gonna play a little bit first, and then I'll talk.
Thank you.
So with improvisation, I think the majority of improvisation, or the majority of what kind of brings about improvisation is context. And, you know, a lot of recordings you'll hear, the improvisations sort of come out of whatever context, you know, there was, whether it's, you know, what kind of studio they were in, what kind of band dynamics, personality is going on, where they are, where they are in the world, when it is in time, all that. You know, the type of context, of course, it's like, you know, it's unlimited, you know. And I think that's, you know, I think that really, that's what makes improvisation is the context and how we sort of reckon with whatever context we place ourselves in or find ourselves in or whatnot. In this case, my context was playing solo, and like I thought of my context being silence and how to best deal with silence, whether I want to fill it up, you know, as I did in the beginning, just play, you know, and kind of, you know, just with this sort of block of sound, or break it up as I would do, you know, as time went on. And also, you know, there are a few moments when I was playing where I was thinking of, you know, sort of playing something that was a little bit more in time, more quote unquote rhythmic. And, you know, it's that silence that you kind of need to work with to shape that rhythm, to shape those phrases. And, you know, whether it's a half note or an eighth note of silence, or it's, you know, 9 or 10 seconds, that's kind of what, that's a building block. And it's kind of about using whatever context you're in as a building block for improvisation. And I think that, for me, having played a lot of different types of music with a lot of different people, a lot of very different types of music within a jazz and improvisation idiom, I've sort of had to rely on what is given to me, whatever piece of music is put in front of me and what other people are playing. I rely on that more than I rely upon my tools and knowledge. And yes, that is essential. You know, you need to practice, you need to learn how to play over whatever set of changes. It's very important stuff, but I think it's nothing without sort of understanding that, you know, I always liken it to really great movies, really great actors, and that, you know, like somebody like Daniel Day-Lewis, you know, I don't know if you guys know him, but he, you know, he's a brilliant actor, but I would say the majority of his brilliance is how he blends into his environment and how he blends into the story and the character, and that all kind of comes together in a very complete way. I wanted to play a few examples just to kind of show a little bit of what I mean about playing within context. This is one example. This is Miles Davis, from Miles Davis and Porgy and Bess. And this is called "This Boat That's Leaving for New York." Is it boat leaving soon for New York? I'll play it for a little bit. Thank you. Okay. Now let's take a deeper look at that. If you don't know this album, you should know it. It's probably my favorite jazz album, period. And it kind of, to me, it shows Miles at sort of the apex of his performance, you know, as an improviser, as a trumpet player, you know, just the true spirit of collaboration between him and Gil Evans, who did the arrangements. Now let's just look at the solo. Okay, so what I really like is that, what I like about this album is that there's a certain dramatism. There's a lot of drama in the writing. You know, there's a lot of, it almost feels very high stakes, you know, really high, you know, trumpet and dense and beautiful, colorful orchestration. It just feels very, there's a lot of weight to it, emotional weight, emotional resonance to it. And, you know, I think Miles, one of the amazing things about Miles to me is that there is deep emotional resonance to his artistry, but it's also very kind of level-headed. It's very, something very even-keeled about him. And you sort of you see that when you watch some videos, you know, of when he would lead his band. You know, he's very observant, and he's takes his time, and he doesn't, you know, he kind of lets other things unfold, and you know, I think with the second quintet, you know, you kind of see, you know, him sort of letting the young, you know, his younger bandmates really take, you know, take the wheel a little more. But I think he was even doing that in this recording already, and I think what's amazing about this is how he lets all the parts play, all the instruments in the band play, and works around that. And that becomes his context to sort of form his statements with. So let's just backtrack a little bit. So, sorry, I keep stopping, but so what I love that happens there, you have the trumpet ending on a really high note here. Really high note. Then he lets that color come in before he comes in. And just, this is to put out there, this is a disclaimer. I don't know how much thought Miles put into these moments. You know, I don't claim to know. This is just me sort of, you know, seeing it and taking it for my own, you know, usage and influence. You know, the trumpets come back in. He also stays out of the range of the trumpets. You know. And he comes down with the French horns come in, blending with their range. He comes back up for the trumpets and back up now. And that's amazing. You have this really piercing high note. You expect it to be the most, you know, like this is the epic moment in the piece. And then he comes in and it's the most gentle thing imaginable. And it's a perfect contrast. And he's with the French horns and the range and rhythmically. And over here, when this chord kind of holds out, he sort of follows the chord. right here. Escapes the chord right when they drop out. Kind of, the other thing is too, it's amazing. I think one thing that, you know, and I'm certainly guilty of this, you know, having, you know, kind of being in the generation I'm in, coming out of the generation before me. But I think in a lot of modern contemporary jazz, there's sort of a little bit of an overcompensation in terms of listening to others. I think people are, it's very easy to sort of go out of your way to show that you're listening to somebody or something. And I don't think you need to work so hard to prove that. I think if you're on the same page with your band and who you're playing with, you can demonstrate that through other ways. You can demonstrate that in conversation and in rehearsal. And when you're playing, you know, I think you just need to play. I think you need to sort of show that you're there to play and not really, you know, like if it, I'm not saying if, you know, if you hear something you like and you want to sort of respond to it, go ahead, you know, but I'm saying like, what I like about this is that Miles is very much in tune with what's going on in arrangement, but he also never forgets that he's Miles. He never forgets, you know, what he's good at, his bread and butter, what he's good at playing, where in the range he feels right and all that. And it's a very, that's what I mean by even keeled, is that like the collaborative energy between him and Gil Evans and the orchestra is abundantly clear without, you know, over-contextualizing, over-compensating you know, the situation he's in. And just, you know, that's what I love about Miles in general, is just, you know, sort of throughout all of his work, is that he manages to sound like himself while still sort of blending in to whatever's going on, whether it's this or, you know, it's Dave Holland and Jack DeJohnette and Ayerto playing together, or it's, you know, Charlie Parker. Like it's really, there's a very clear continuum through him. Does anybody have any questions, any thoughts on Miles? I'm just kind of curious. No? All right.
Well, one thing that I could add, if I may, Adam, this is great. You brought up a lot of really beautiful points. I think it's something for all of us to think about, regardless of instrument. Miles is also, as we probably know, a master of space, and what he doesn't play is often just as important as what he does play. So there's a power of implication that a lot of young musicians, I think, are trying to reach. You know, I've heard a lot of players and taught a lot, and I kind of see it. That once they learn how to leave that space and learn how to let the music sort of be in that moment and just relax, that's when the great things start to happen. And for a lot of musicians, it seems to happen at different times in their careers. But I just had a meeting earlier with Bob Franciscini, and he was saying the same thing. He was like, just kind of going with the flow sometimes is exactly what's going to get you the best result. Mm. When you improvised, you know, fitting into the kind, this whole thing about context makes a lot of sense, because that's really what it is. Because in a different context, you might play the exact same thing and it wouldn't work. But because it's in the context that you're playing it in, if you're making the right choice, then it's going to feel like it belongs there. And I think that's partly what Adam is saying, that or maybe that's totally what he's saying, that, you know, taken into another context, and it would have a completely different place. And he does blend it in. Miles does blend in, and he does react to what the band is doing. And none of us know what he was thinking, but we do know how he's reacting. And we do know his, you can hear it through his horn, you know, the sincerity. So anyway, that's just my little two cents on what you were saying. That's really cool, man. It's a great example to bring up, because it is a complex environment for him to be in. Mm-hmm. I think he actually claimed that this was one of the hardest things he ever had to do, was this record. Mm. I read that.
That's why it's his best work, you know? Yeah. Well, I want to do a little more listening. Kind of still on the subject of context, but a little, you know, part of what I did when I first played in the beginning was, you know, kind of trying to create my own context, and both live in the context I was, you know, sort of in the middle of, but also from that context, if you will, create subcontext, you know, and kind of create like a universe, create a world from universe, or I don't know, man, I'm not that good with words, but you know, like just like kind of taking, like when you start a solo, I think you kind of have like a, it's almost like a dual responsibility. Like you want to, not even dual, there's a lot of responsibility. You want to play the tune, I think, first and foremost, whether it's that tune or it's a graphic composition along the lines of Wadada Leo Smith, or it's, you know, you have to play the tune. And I think that's, you know, no brainer, first and foremost. And then you kind of need to sort of, I think you need to sort of, the second responsibility is knowing how to flesh out, you know, your purpose on playing on a tune, and knowing sort of, you know, having an idea of what you're trying to say and how to say it, and you know, within that context. Let's just listen to something. Let's listen to something. Thank you. So I want to try something. You guys have like a raise hand function on Zoom, right? Like you guys all, I think you can do that. Am I correct? It's like if you want to, I think it's, I don't remember where it is. Right, Zach?
Yeah. If people want to raise their hands, they can go, where is it?
Under reactions.
Reactions?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So here, I want to try something. I'm going to play that track from the beginning again, and I want you guys to raise your hand where you think the solo starts. Okay? All right. Okay, do some of you weren't sure if the solo started or not, or maybe didn't, anyway, this tune is really interesting because, it's, you know, it kind of starts in this way that, you know, kind of sounds like a, I don't know, like a child, like a children's song, you know. It's very, very sort of kind of major, but also a little weird, distorted, but also still sort of in that, you know, it's kind of spiraling out a little bit. Still has a shade, a hint of that kind of original C major melodic vibe. It's kind of both at the same time. Now it's happy. Back into the weird. Okay, so that's where the improvisation starts, right there. With this tune, so there's kind of this context, I think that's sort of established. And to kind of articulate that the best I can, I would say there's sort of a duality between this kind of bright melodic C major sort of thing, you know, and kind of bouncy, childlike sort of vibe, all twisted up in this other thing, you know, this kind of more outside of the frame, if you will, material, you know, and
this dire kinda got back to me.
What happened? I think somebody's mic is on. No. Anyway, so, you know, this is like, there's two things going on. There's this, you know, very joyous kind of thing and very clear, joyous C major thing, and then the other kind of chromatic disjointedness to it. And so let's just listen to the solo from this point on. It's kind of going back and forth between these two sort of approaches, colors. So what I kind of see this as is a way of fostering the relationship between dissonance and diatonicism. And I think one of the things we struggle with as improvisers is, you know, kind of sometimes feeling, well, just it's easy to sort of look at it in a narrow-minded way that, like, if we want to sort of take things to another level, we play a note, like we play an F sharp over a F7 or whatever, or you know what I mean. And I think it's much more complicated than that. I think, you know, you can't really just tack something on and expect it to be musical. It just doesn't really work like that. And that's not just to say that's my philosophy, like my musical philosophy, but I, you know, it's you know, like certain colors, you know, if you're trying to, depending on what you're trying to say, certain colors don't necessarily go together, or you know, you don't, I mean, it's an age old example, but you don't want to make like a peanut butter cucumber sandwich, you know. It might, like when you're improvising, it might be cool to do that, and sometimes it is. I'm not, you know, I try and paint these things as least black and white as possible. But I think, again, this is my thing about context, you know. This tune starts out in a way that clearly illustrates this dance between dissonance and diatonicism. And what the improviser is doing is fleshing that out in his own improvisation. He's just expanding upon the themes that are already established right from the beginning. Just as Miles was on the other tune, it's different, you know, he's working with the big band, and there's all these other things kind of coming into play, but it's the same thing of sort of, you know, working with what he's given and working with what's there. Let me just fast forward a little bit in this track. Let me go a little forward. Mm-hmm. All right, so this is towards the end of the solo, coming back into the middle, into the head out. He's kind of finding that middle ground more and more. Now it's coming much more into the C major melody thing, recalling the beginning more and kind of signaling that he's getting back to the melody head out. The other thing I find interesting about that moment is that in the beginning, you know, it's much more light in this, you know, C thing. And then when he's coming out of the solo at the end, you know, it's like right there. Not, he's not doing the melody out the way he did it in. He's doing it, you know, as if he just climbed through all this and kind of came to a different conclusion about what it all means, you know? So that was a tune called Saints by the Craig Taborn Trio. And I told Zach that I could make a playlist of the different stuff that we've been, I've only listened to two tunes, I've been talking more. Anybody have any questions or sort of thoughts about sort of this sort of duality, and or I guess I'm curious, like, if anybody would be willing to volunteer, especially a horn player, a pianist, improviser, on a melodic instrument, if anybody would be willing to volunteer to sort of express a little bit their own mindset when making certain decisions about, I don't know, like taking things out of the changes, if you want to call it that. Does anybody have any students want to volunteer their own thoughts, their own experience with that?
I kind of started off with having more of a question about what you thought, just about the idea of like creating elements of surprise within like a context, because I feel like something we've been talking about is like, you know, number one, you have to like somehow relate to or like recognize like what's going on. But then number two, it's like to create something like interesting within that, mm-hmm. you have to like somehow rub against it in a way.
Yeah.
I don't know. So I guess, I mean, that's kind of like at least my thought about it, but then also like a question as to like how you personally think about that, because I don't know. I guess one other thing that comes to mind is sometimes you hear people within different contexts and like they can sound like wildly different, like their language, and I don't know, like basic example, like someone playing in like a more bebop group and then they're playing with the blues kind of band or something like that, and then suddenly they're just like, you know, playing all these like whatever quote unquote like bluesy licks stuff, right. I don't know, like people are like, sometimes you notice people like changing their aesthetic almost like to different contexts.
Well, one thing that occurred to me just in a second, for some reason I never really thought about it before, but it's kind of obvious, you know, that you know, with like Miles's, I know I keep talking about Miles, but how could you not, with Miles's first quintet, you know, how they did a lot of standards that were, you know, Broadway tunes, show tunes, and same with, like, you know, looking at sort of what Oscar Peterson did with some of that, or Ahmad Jamal, plenty of people. But I think what speaks to me about that, what that speaks to me is the fact that, you know, I think you'll find yourself surprised the more you delve into something that is that might be sort of foreign to you than if you're kind of digging into your own sort of tools that you've accumulated and sort of preferences that you've accumulated as, like, you know, and sort of what kind of music you like, what kind of music you like to play. I think part of the surprise comes from, you know, kind of really getting into, like, kind of really dealing with a song on its most basic level, you know, you know, I mean, there's the Brad Mehldau version of I Didn't Know What Time It Was is a masterpiece, but for me to really understand that song, you need to go back to, you know, I think there's a Billie Holiday version. There's a really great version by Bobby Timmons. You kind of need to, just because, like, when I hear those earlier versions, I hear where Brad was coming from, you know? And I think it is tricky, though. You know, it's tricky. I think it's something that we all struggle with a lot, is how to, you know, embrace history and, you know, kind of forge our own paths forward, you know, and that's, there's never ever going to be an easy answer to that. You know, it's just, you give up trying to find a straight solution, honestly, because it's always going to be a dance. It's always going to be, and that sort of balancing act. And that's, to me, that's where the surprise comes from, is being surprised, especially when you read a book that's like 100 years old, man. Like, you know, you're surprised by, like, how much it resonates with you despite not growing up in that time, you know? And I think that is really, you know, I think that also means you need to sort of get past this thing of like, oh, this is old, I'm just studying this to learn the history. You're studying this to learn about yourself, you know? And that's really what it is, you know, of listening to all kinds of music from everywhere, from every time period, is to find out more about yourself, you know?
And maybe to add on to that, no matter how much you try to sound like somebody else, or no matter how many solos you transcribe, you still gonna sound like yourself.
Well, right? You know,
I mean, you might temporarily divert, but you're gonna end up coming back.
See, I don't know. I think it's very easy for people to prioritize such a thing so heavily that they lose sight of themselves and are only focused on one sort of goal, and you know, I do think there, you know, I don't want to sound judgmental, but I think there are people who, you know, spend a lot of time you know, learning one language, or learning about one player, one period of music, and are learning it more for the sake of mastering it than actually thinking about sort of the broader picture of things, you know. Zach, there's one other thing I wanted to get into. How much time do we have left?
We have no hard and fast time limits. You can talk.
Nobody's got to go anywhere.
As long as you want. Yeah, everyone's got gigs to rehearse to get to. All
right, I got to make sure I catch the key train.
I got to go to my dentist after this. Come on.
All right.
Actually, I gotta jump off, because literally I've been on Zoom all day, and I'm gonna practice a little bit. Adam's inspired me. So I'm gonna go shed a little bit, guys, because I haven't seen the horn since, I don't know, early yesterday. So
it has feelings,
Zach,
too.
Zach and Adam, and I just want to thank you guys. I really encourage you guys to do this more. And I wrote you a note. I'm going to send it in the chat. And please let me know when other ones happen, and I'll pass it along to the students. And we'll have you guys come onto a meeting with the LaGuardia kids, and you guys we'll come up with some topics, and you guys can share some of your experiences, okay? And cool. And connect and so forth. I think it's beautiful. So just yeah, man. Thanks so much.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, really thanks for doing this. I'm really glad to see all these people here. But I'm gonna jump off because literally I have just a little bit of time to shed, and then it's dinner, and then you know the deal. So but anyway, it's great to see you guys. And please keep in touch, and know that, you know, I'm always thinking about you guys. We've been having some alum reunions and stuff. It's been real cool. So I'll be in touch with you guys.
Please, yeah.
Join me.
Yeah, enjoy the session, and thanks so much for sharing. I'll see you guys. Thanks a lot.
Cool. Yeah, so, you can keep going.
Cool. So the one other thing I wanted to get into, and also if anybody has any questions about what we just talked about too, you know, feel free. But one thing I did want to get into, and this is kind of, you know, I've been kind of talking a lot and listening to a lot of music and you know, talking about a little bit more of the conceptual, you know, approach and all that. I want to get into a little bit more, that Zach, make sure you focus. I don't know if I think your video is unfocused. Maybe I'm wrong. What I want to talk to you guys about, you know, I just off. Oh, my bad. Sorry. As I said, it's very hard to find that balancing point between learning the history and learning changes, learning tunes, and all that, and balancing that with forming your own ideas about things and different methods and all that. I'm just gonna say it. I can't teach you about. I don't think I can teach you well about playing changes. I and I'm saying this because I learned in ways that it's not so simple the way I learned. Much of it was by instinct and just listening to recordings and just relying upon my ears, and also having the Abersold 251 book. And, you know, it's kind of mishmash of methods that, like, in terms of playing harmony and playing changes, I don't feel necessarily like the leading authority on that, in terms of expressing that. But what I do want to talk about is the idea of, sort of creating your own ideas, the idea of creating your own ideas. So I'm gonna play a little bit again, but you know, I'm just gonna play a little bit and I'll stop. Things that happened. One,
there was one shape that I kind of came back to occasionally. And that's the those are the notes, but I also came back to groupings of five quite often. So so sometimes when I play solo, well, usually when I practice, I do all my long tones and all the nitty gritty stuff, trumpet stuff. If you're not a trumpet player, stay far away. And what I do after I, kind of get through my thing, I usually just play a little bit. You know, I just, you know, it doesn't matter. Maybe I'll play a tune, maybe I won't. And the fun thing is when I play and I kind of hear like a little fragment of something that's sort of tripping me up. And then I sort of spend the next month or two just working on one of those phrases. And I sort of create methodology around each phrase that I sort of stumble upon. So let's look at this one again. So what I might do, since it's five notes, it also gives me an opportunity to work on my my quintuplets. And that's always fun. Let me know if you guys can hear this metronome all right. If not, I'll figure out a different thing to do. But all right, so oops, sorry. You hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So the chord note is 40 there. I'm gonna start with let's start with quintuplets. So been a while since I've done this. Just in case, I don't know how much experience you guys have with tuplets and you know, quintuplets and all that. What I usually do is sort of within each beat, sing out each grouping of five. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And so then I put notes on that from the phrase I made. And sometimes I actually even inflict more punishment upon myself and do a quintuplet half note. So I can't do that. but yeah, so that what Now that's kind of the bare sort of phrase in itself, detached from what I just, the improvisation I did, and just kind of putting that with metronome. And my suggestion is to start slow, like I did, around 40. And with any phrase, you know, it doesn't matter. That start slow. That's the moral of the story. And so now let's talking about kind of taking that a little bit more into the realm of tonality, I guess, music. So thinking about those notes. Those notes are in B major scale, concert B major. And so I'm gonna just kind of play an example of how I would make this an exercise. I'm gonna turn the metronome up a little bit. So what I encourage you, the way I would encourage you to all approach this, and honestly, drummers, I would say you can kind of do a version of this too. It's a little different because you don't have pitches, but I think you can work, you know, try like, I don't know, each eighth note is on like a different part of a drum set or something like that. Just to kind of, it's a good way to expand your orchestrational textural palette a bit too, you know. But anyway, what I would suggest for approaching this sort of thing is to do exactly what I did. I just played solo for about a minute, and I found that there are a few phrases that I held on to, and I chopped it out of there, and I put a metronome on it, and I started it where it was, and then I took it into other keys, and you know, and the other thing too with here's the difference between doing this and, well, maybe there's no difference actually. I think with both doing this and when you practice exercises, you know, out of a jazz harmony book or whatnot, you know, the ultimate goal shouldn't necessarily be to use these things verbatim. You know, it's more about sort of developing a fluidity. In this case, my concern with developing a fluidity with quintuplets and with a certain intervallic shape. When I practice an exercise out of a 2-5-1 book, it's just about developing a sense of fluidity with 2-5-1s. It's not about playing that exercise. That being said, I think when you first learn something, it's very natural to, you know, kind of find yourself just playing something verbatim, just to learn how to execute it and understand context and understand how to work it into that context. But I think it should always be in the back of your head don't let it be the ultimate goal to play, you know, like I have other exercises that I don't even remember at all. And because they just kind of have just threaded into my playing at this point. But it's because I spent some time, you know, analyzing myself in the moment and sort of making an exercise out of it and sculpting it, that's what matters. You know, it doesn't really matter, like an improvisation, you know, it'll happen and then it won't, you know.
And the other thing I would say, a good way of approaching this too, record these improvisations you do, record it in case you miss it, in case you don't catch something when you first play it, in case you want to listen back and then find your exercise and find your phrase or shape or whatever. You don't feel too pressured to, make something right away. Everybody works to their own pace, so it's okay. I think it's just, that's sort of the, think about you, like when you're doing this, think about like what you like, just play and don't think about whether it can fit a certain set of changes, just play, and you play something that feels right, explore it, any thoughts?
I have a question. I really enjoyed hearing you talk about this. I really enjoy creating my own exercises in the practice room by myself, but I get intimidated by not knowing when to stop doing permutations or when I should really be exploring new permutations. What you just did was a good demonstration of how to work different skills, like at the same time, whether it's something that's challenging you rhythmically or a certain shape that you want to explore. But I noticed that you did it only scalar, in like the kind of, the 12 modes of, or no, not 12 modes, however many modes there are of the major scale. I was wondering, if it would be worth taking it further than modes of that scale or exploring more chromaticism, because, that's basically what I have to say.
Mm-hmm. I got a few, I see in the chat, a few guys were asking me to demonstrate that over a tune. Is that what you meant, just kind of in like sort of a non-scalar context, I guess?
Yeah, particularly, like in a practical way.
Okay. I'll play a little bit of a blues and I'll show you a little bit what I mean.
Awesome. Thank you.
Too, is that, I'm thinking of it, sort of as also a way to link something to something else, and not always in terms of thinking about, was that clear, kind of the way I figured that exercise into it? Cool. I treat it more it's become second nature to me at this point, like certain shapes and I think you kind of already want to have it in your back of your head that it's maybe less a statement and more just sort of a connective tissue, and that like you can play something
and it can kind of lead to another moment, and it's, and it, 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 you know, but yeah. Anybody else have any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. It's more about what we heard, like Craig's trio, and yeah. How, like for me at the beginning also, their connection, I don't know, it was so like in all of them together. So I guess maybe like it's how the trio kind of, you know, they're working together a lot, but more about developing kind of interaction between, you know, when you're playing with others or stuff like that, like how to get to this point, you know, when you don't, yeah. You don't think about it, it just happens. Like for me, I'm just, you know, listening to whatever is going on, and then like it kind of building itself.
Man, can you, yeah. Can you, Zach,
what's good?
Can is it possible? Cause I'm not using my computer, and is it possible if I go onto my iPad and continue this from there? Is that gonna be hard? Cause that's a good question. I don't want to rush through it.
That's not too hard. You can go over to your iPad if you have Zoom on it. You might not be equipped to play music.
That's fine. But, I think we can just talk at this point. Are you guys cool if it'll take like a minute just to transfer over?
I'll sit here and tap dance.
Yeah, let Zach tap dance.
8 hours later.
There he is.
Yo, sorry about that, guys. My iPad was having issues. Now I'm on my phone.
Oh.
There we go. All right. So is Omer still there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Cool. Could you repeat your question?
I guess more like about developing interaction between, like when you're playing with people and stuff.
Because
when we heard the recording from the beginning already, like when the bass came in, you already knew that, you know, everything else is going to be just, you know, very conversational kind of way with them. So I guess just like how you think about like when interacting with people, because for me, I'm kind of, you know, just hearing whatever is happening, but I don't want to, you know, keep on looking for that thing and then like answer that, just like kind of make it happen naturally. So I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, well, first thing I would say, you know, cut yourself some slack. I think everybody's eager to play, you know, and everybody's eager to show that they're eager to play, you know, and if you're not eager to show that you're eager to play, then that's your problem. That means you're not showing full appreciation of the moment and the opportunity to play. So I think don't limit yourself because you think it might look one way or the other, you know? I think, you know, you have to kind of trust in both of you, both yourself and the others you're playing with, especially the others you're playing with, because it's when you trust your bandmates, whoever you're playing with, it's in that moment that you're able to really let go, I think, and lose yourself. And if you're constantly worried how someone is going to respond to what you do, then that's going to be very prohibitive, I think. You know, I had one of the first experiences I had going on the road was with Rudresh Mahanthappa, and we were playing, it was the first tour I ever done of Europe, like first multi-country tour, and we were playing a gig in Spain, and we had this tune where we like kind of, you know, actually every tune we ended up sort of trading each other, but there was this moment where we were playing together, and during the gig, like on stage, Rudresh stops playing and says, "Stop playing what I'm playing." And
I remember feeling really, really, you know, really bad afterwards, you know, like I made a mistake or something like that. And, you know, I didn't make a mistake, but I did learn something about moderation and balance and, you know, finding sort of the right moment for the right time and that, you know, you can't really take things too absolutely, I think is what I kind of, you know, because I think after that moment, I was very hesitant to ever play something that somebody else was playing in the moment. And eventually I learned to sort of allow myself, that's what I mean by cutting yourself in slack. Like you kind of have to allow yourself to, you know, satisfy your own needs and the needs of others around you. You know?
Yeah, for sure. No.
Yeah. Can you hear me all right? Just because it's a little windy outside. I hope it's okay.
Yeah. It's windy here also, so I don't know.
Okay. cool.
Okay. No, that's a cool way of thinking. Yeah, I don't know. I don't get, like, nervous about it. It's just, like, sometimes I hear something and I want to kind of, you know, add to that, and sometimes it's just like when the timing is kind of happening, I guess. I don't know.
We don't know.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. We really don't. And I think we need to the sooner we accept that we don't know, and that, you know, again, the thing about absolute is, you know, we don't know, but we also do know, you know. Like we can feel it when it feels right. And I would say one way that I this sounds very modest, but I would say I don't really consider myself the most original, just because so much of what I do comes from recordings, you know, so many of the choices I make come from, that's not to say that I find new things to sort of say. But I don't think that, like, I, so much of my timing as an improviser comes from hearing what other people do, you know? And that's just timing, you know? Like, I think it's okay to sort of take cues from someone else, especially when we don't know, you know? And I think it's sort of acknowledging that sometimes we do need to sort of go from the expected moment to go to the unexpected moment, you know? You kind of need to be able to explore both kind of concurrently, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Does anybody else have any questions?
So do you take most of these things from, like, things that you transcribe, or, like, how do, like, you take from, like, transcribing, like, you kind of listen and take it to your own, but, you know, give an idea of how to kind of add to your own, you know, vocab and stuff like that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't really transcribe, like, pen to paper that much. It's a little more instinctual to me. Like, if I hear somebody play a phrase that I like, I kind of steal it right away and find a way as soon as possible to sort of integrate it into something. So it's a little more just kind of, I definitely take a more impressionistic approach to it, I would say, you know, like kind of just taking moments and finding my own way to recreate moments in my own, through my perspective and through sort of the context of what's going on, like which band I'm playing with, especially, it's especially fun when you're playing with a band or a project or a book of music that, is very foreign from the influence that you're kind of implementing onto it, you know, and I think when you look at things a little more abstractly and impressionistically, it kind of tears down a little bit of the stylistic genre sort of borders between things, and you know, it's pretty abstract though. You kind of need to abstracticize it to make it work sometimes, you know.
Yeah, for sure.
Adam, you've gotten a couple of people asking about technical exercises.
Oh, okay, cool. Let's see. I see. What tech exercises do you practice right now? Long tones. Lots of long tones. I'll never stop practicing long tones. You know, I would say most, if I practice at all, like if I get an hour in, it's going to be an hour of long tones, like no doubt, just because I can't even remember, it was somebody else who said it to me, but like the thing you hear on any instrument is somebody's sound, you know, like that's the first thing you hear, and that I think that's the priority, is your sound, and like doing you know, Arvind from Charlier, that stuff is essential, but I don't think any of it will ever overtake the essentiality of long tones. That's my trumpet philosophy. And just, you know, to elaborate on long tones a little bit, I start on middle G, and I go to F sharp below, and then G sharp. But rather than going back to F, I go to A, and then F, and then E, then B flat. So it's like kind of back and forth, but not so like, I think the book, what it says is to start on G, then F sharp, then G sharp, then F, then A. You're kind of getting farther and farther apart on both extreme. But I think that's not as good for your chops. You can't do that much drastic sort of flip-flopping on your chops, I don't think. I've never felt good by it. So what I usually like to do is, you know, start on G, then go to the F sharp next to it, and then the G sharp right above it, then go to the A, and then go down a third to the F, and then to the E right next to it, and then back up to the B flat, and then the B, and then E flat. Does that make sense? Like kind of, so you're spending more than a second on each side of your range. You know, you're not doing this like constant bouncing back and forth quite as much. In terms of non-long tone stuff, the thing I showed you before with taking a fragment of an improvisation, that, believe it or not, is the second thing I usually do after long tones. I have other intervallic exercises that I do based on things I heard or things I played. I don't have that many of them written down, but I suffice it to say, the only thing I really practice out of a book usually is tonguing stuff. I have, my friend years ago sent me a trumpet sheet music Dropbox page, and every now and then I go to that Dropbox page and pick a book to practice exercises out of, and that's what I do. You know, sometimes I'll practice Charlie etudes or find other etudes to practice. Actually, there's a really good book. I don't know what the name of the book is. I could send it to the trumpet player if you're interested. But I like to practice out of it, and it's a book of Italian etudes of songs that were written for voice and then sort of transposed for trumpet. And that stuff is incredible for like sound, and you know, it's very lyrical. They're called vocalese, the etudes, and that is a really good book, and I can send the trumpet players a PDF of that.
Maybe you know, the same, you know, people who send me their emails on the chat, I'll make sure that we send them the playlist and any other materials you're talking about, or if you have any PDFs of anything, or just names of books, whatever it might be, just, you know, send that to me and I'll make sure to pass it along to everyone.
Definitely. Any other what exercise did you so I think everybody sees that question, right? Internalizing sorry, how do I go back to the questions? Oh, I see. Well, I don't know. A tricky question. I mean, I've gone through periods of where I've really made a conscious effort to work on my time and you know, do exercises like the one I showed you, the quintuplets, you know, and I'm in that phase right now where I do those kind of exercises, and that helps a lot. But I also have some maybe more unorthodox exercises as well. When I was in college, I occasionally would put on this Aphex Twin album, Drux, I think it's called. I can send that to you guys. And there's a few tracks on there that are really like, I mean, the thing about electronic music, it's, you know, there's a level of precision that is possible through electronic music that just isn't possible, I think. And there's nothing wrong with that. No, not good or bad. It's just the truth, you know? But that's what makes it fun to like play along with that stuff is it's like, you know, to play along with something that is not human. It really like it sort of accesses a different side of you that you didn't think ever existed. And a lot of people would never think of ever, you know, playing with, I guess like in terms of jazz improvisation, the lineage of jazz improvisers, and who would have thought that we'd have the opportunity to play along with beats and, you know, break beat and electronic stuff and make stuff and quantize it and play along with it. That's such a golden opportunity. And that's something that I think is really good for developing rhythmic accuracy. And it's not, you shouldn't think of it necessarily with the goal to like play like you are an electronic instrument. But I think it's more just a sort of, well, it's a way of embracing the time we live in right now, for one thing, without succumbing to it. And it's just, you know, it's a level of accuracy that I think is there's a lot to benefit and learn from in that. In terms of, you know, other ways I've come to develop, I don't remember, rhythmic, interplanetary, no. Playing a lot of different types of music with a lot of different types of people. You know, I've grew up playing in big bands for one thing, and that, you know, playing in a big band, I know when you're in high school or college, it seems like a chore, but playing in a big band is one of the most essential experiences you can have as a musician. You're learning to work with 15, 16 other people and to make sure you're all in the same place with each other and create something that sounds good. I mean, that's a huge feat. And if you don't understand what an undertaking that is, then I hate to say it, but you're misguided. Playing in a big band is really one of the most important things you can do as a musician. It's great for developing rhythmic. You wouldn't think it's good for developing rhythmic independence because you're playing with 14 other people and you're all in the same place. But the truth is that your trumpet four part is so important. And if that part is out of sync with everything, then everybody knows. You don't think everybody knows, but everybody knows. And everybody knows without necessarily knowing that it's trumpet four, but everybody knows because the band sounds fucked up, you know? So, like, don't undervalue playing in a big band. That's incredibly, incredibly important. And then, you know, my last answer to this question is that I just tried stuff. I tried stuff from a very early age. I would play things intentionally, juxtaposed against whatever was going on, whether it made sense or not. And you need to give yourself room and opportunities to do that. You know, you need to like really go for broke every now and then. I hope that answers. that question. Oh, and also just like, you got to fall in love with the measurements. Like, you know, like, you have to, like, it's playing with a machine, but you know, that machine is one of the most beneficial machines that's ever been made. Fall in love with it. There are a few other questions in the chat. Composition process. I don't really have a composition process, I'm afraid to say. I have many different approaches that I take with it. Some of it is sitting down at the piano and just, you know, kind of seeing what comes out. Some of it is taking a stylistic sort of, I would say one approach that has guided me throughout my time as a composer so far is the practice of stylistic pastiche and, you know, hearing something that you love and trying to recreate it. And kind of what I was talking about with Omer before, you know, kind of trying to recreate it through your own lens. And I can send it to you guys. I can send it to Zach. I have a tune on YouTube called Shadows Persist with my nonet. And the drum beat is lifted verbatim from the tune by Tom York. And I don't really have a lot of shame in that, just because I did enough to make it feel like it's my own. The rest of the tune, it's you know. But sometimes you just got to. Sometimes you gotta just, you hear a chord you like, you hear a progression you like, sometimes you just got to. But make sure you also aren't ripping off the thing too. Make sure make sure it still feels like you and you're not just cashing in on the fact that something exists already, you know? Composition, I'm just trying to think. I mean, I think one thing that's good for composers and something that I haven't followed too well is, creating a structure before you write a piece, which I've done before. I wrote a suite of music for solo clarinet. I think it's on my SoundCloud. And my teacher, I was studying with a classical teacher at MSN at the time, and he had me decide what the structure of the piece was beforehand, and that's a good method. I don't follow it enough. I it's really hard for me to sit down and like sketch something out before I hear what it is. It can be prohibitive too. Sometimes you need to let yourself go loose when writing as much as you when playing. But it is a good method. Honestly, the best compositional advice I can give is to find a teacher. You know, like, you need to have somebody who's looking at the music. You know what? I know I thought I didn't have an answer to this question. The last thing I'm going to say about composition is sometimes you just need to write. You just need to write and write and write and don't stop writing and go back later to look at it and rewrite it. You don't want to like be writing something and kind of constantly like every 5 seconds going back to the measure before changing it. You just need to get it out of your system and then later rewrite it. Go through what works and what doesn't work. If you're gonna waste so much time and energy constantly writing and rewriting, you gotta just write it and then rewrite it. A few more questions.
What tools do you use to compose? Like, do you kind of flesh out demos, or do you tend to just like pick it out on the piano and kind of just like write the lines down and then bring it into the band and kind of see how it sounds then?
It's always different. I've done the thing of lately in the past year or two, I've experimented more with creating a demo in Logic sort of writing something based on that and based on a groove I create in Logic or beat I create in Logic. I try not to like stay too much with one thing because I think like I found myself kind of, you know, with my band Stranger Days, we had a personnel change about 2 years ago now. No, a year ago. You know, I was kind of seeing that at first I was seeing it as this moment to sort of like hit reset on the band and apply a whole new method of composition and arrangement and stuff, like new stylistic approach completely, and you know, kind of treating it as a reboot, whatever. You know, I brought in a few things that I had written in Logic, or at least wrote like the shell of Logic, and sorry, and I found that I was sort of betraying. First, I found that I was sort of betraying the spirit of the band, and what point we had come to when I wasn't writing like that. And within that feeling, I kind of felt like I don't believe I don't believe in the fact that we I don't think we change as much as we think we do individually, and I think we can make big changes, but I think the core of us is always there, and I think we should embrace that. And so as many new methods I kind of come across in terms of writing, I kind of feel like I need to kind of, you know, my roots as a composer are sitting at a piano, you know, and I kind of always need to have that because it is where I come from, no matter what other methods I come across, you know. Does that answer? I don't know. I don't know if I'm bad at remembering questions.
Yeah, I think so.
Adam, you actually had someone asking specifically about Shadows Persist also.
Oh yeah. Tom York. No. Tom, I mean, seriously, like that tune came out of wanting to write a Tom York style tune. And that's where it started. Like I was really just trying to, like, I was super obsessed with his music. That was what I was trying to do. That being said, that project came at an interesting moment, where I had played a gig. It was a really weird gig. It was a gig that was sort of put together by a presenter and team and all of that, and a festival, and it was kind of, you know, sort of presented as this sort of all-star sort of thing. I came out of it feeling a little dissatisfied. I was sort of dissatisfied with, I guess, that sort of approach that has been such a thing with jazz, you know. It's like kind of this jazz all-star thing. I don't know. It's true. I have mixed feelings about it, suffice to say. And I didn't really feel like a star, to be honest. I didn't feel right, you know. I didn't feel right, and I didn't feel authoritative. And Zack was here later after the gig. Me, Zack, and a friend of ours went over to his place and watched the Miles Davis Isle of Wight video from like '69, I think. And it's amazing. It's Miles, I think Benny Maupin, Chick and Keith Jarrett, Jack DeJohnette, Dave Holland, and Ayerto, I think that's the whole band. And I was really moved by the collective energy in that video. And there was sort of this moment like of watching that right after getting off stage and feeling like really like dissatisfied with sort of being the featured soloist or whatever. And so I wanted to start a band where I wasn't the only trumpet player. And one of my best friends, one of my favorite trumpet players, Nolan Sang, was the other trumpet player. We went to school together. And I sort of started building the band one by one. I think the first person, I don't remember the first person I called. But anyway, I started building the band piece by piece, and it was made up of some, for Shadows Persist, I mean, it was made up of people kind of, I was sort of modeling it a little bit after that Isle of Wight band and that energy and sort of that fusion, collective sort of vibe. And my friend Russell Holzman, he had introduced me to the Thom Yorke album, and you know, so I sort of wrote the beat for him as well. You know, I didn't write the beat. I think that music, you know, a big goal of mine was to sort of remove myself from the spotlight. And this is just to say, like, I'm extremely grateful for all the opportunities I've been given up to this point, and just gotten to be featured and play with so many people and amazing people. But I kind of needed to sort of remove myself from that sort of, and I thought playing with another trumpet player was really great, and not being featured. I think I took one solo in the whole book of music and kind of made sure to, you know, sort of do that. But yeah, I mean, that's the inspiration that's the main inspiration of that band, I would say, in that project, that music, just kind of almost recontextualizing. I know I keep using that word, but, you know, I was sort of recontextualizing my own place as a trumpet player, as a band leader, you know, focusing more on myself as a band leader, even treating it more like a director, you know, and kind of taking that approach more. And funny enough, what came out of it was that I wanted to play with Stranger Days more than ever. I wanted to solo. I wanted to like really play a lot of solos, play long solos, play with a quartet, you know. It was kind of what it wasn't. I kind of went looking for something else entirely, and it kind of brought me back to what I was kind of saying no to for a second, you know. So yeah, that band and that music was a very important moment for me. Let's see, what are there are a few other questions, right? I mean, does anybody have any questions about my emotional realization? Favorite chordless quartet groups. I was actually listening to the Mark Turner album recently, the Lathe of Heaven came out a few years ago. Charles Mingus Presents Charles Mingus is amazing, with Ted Kurse and Eric Dolphy and Danny Richman. Chordless quartet. Ornette Coleman, a few of his albums I really love. There's one I was listening to, Ornette, I think it's just called Ornette, with an exclamation mark. And there's also, what is it called? It's The Other Side of Love Call. It's like the other, there's two albums in the same band with, I forget who's on. Oh, Dewey Redman. There's two albums. Cordless Quartet. It's funny. I played in a lot of Cordless Quartets. For a few years, I was doing a lot of Cordless Quartet gigs, and they were all completely different. And it was really fun. Playing in my band was completely different than playing with Stephan Crump's band or some of the other people. And I think it's cool because it kind of demonstrates the versatility of such a bare bones instrumentation. You know, like you can really. I'm still finding, as I'm continuing to write for my band, like I'm still finding like the possibilities are endless with that instrumentation. And it's really, really cool to see that. There was a question about improving and strengthening your range. sometimes you kind of just need to normalize some of that stuff a little bit, with like high notes. You need to normalize the fact that they're high notes. You can't look at them like they're this unachievable thing. And so what I mean by that is sometimes when I'm soloing, I just go for a note, whether or not I can hit it. And I go for it and I go for it and I go for it. And in addition to that, I do long tones, and I did the stamp exercise book for a while. I do think the best way to learn is just kind of like, and also if you have access to like lead trumpet parts just by themselves, I think that's a really good tool. I had a really good teacher named Nathan Warner when I was in high school, and he was amazing for developing range, and he had me do the stamp book. I think it's just called Stamp Trumpet Book. I don't really remember, doing the book, doing it by the book, but also just kind of making it less sort of scary, Anybody else have any questions?
This might be a... Oh, Max Dolgen raised his Zoom hand.
Yeah. Max.
Adam, I guess I was just wondering, like, how have you found is the best way for you to kind of be able to put yourself out for people, for other people to say, oh, I want Adam to come play on this gig? Like, what have you kind of used to get yourself out there?
Well, I think, what did we say about balancing understanding a language and a history and understanding yourself? And I think it's the same thing. For better or worse, a lot of people like what they're comfortable with. And I think that's, unfortunately, I find that way more with rhythm section. Like people are much less willing to take chances on rhythm section players, which is sad, because they so many people kind of treat it as it has to be the solid foundation. And there's a lot of truth to that, but, I think it means that it's a little harder for I think there's way too much pressure on rhythm section players to sort of be solid as a rock and give exactly what the band leader wants, And it's kind of limiting too, so I think the key is to look at the players who are able to kind of strike the right balance. For me, Ambrose was one of those. Ralph Alessi, Avishai Cohen, Jonathan Finlayson, people who trumpet players who, are really have a deep understanding of the history and language, but also totally sound like themselves. Mm-hmm. And it's the same, I think like that's what makes Marcus Gilmore one of our great artists in general, and not just drummers, is that he has such a deep understanding of history and tradition, but is also one of the most groundbreaking musicians of our time, you know. And you know, that's, I think the other thing too, you know, like, it's a choice you have to make. You know, you have to make that choice if you want to be like somebody who's going to be working a lot with a lot of different people, or if you want to be somebody who's going to sort of create their own kind of networking system. And I don't know if it means you can't have both, but I think it is sort of a choice. And that choice to me means you need to be willing to, you know, make such a dirty word, compromise. You know, you need to be willing, not compromise, that's harsh, but I think you need to be willing to give people what they need, you know. And but you don't do that to the point where it hurts yourself, you know. That's the line. But I think that's what I have come to understand is especially, you know, kind of, you know, I did Granny Band 3 times, Next Gen, all, you know, Young Arts, did that stuff. I went to MSM, you know, and I kind of went through that whole track playing the right notes. I'm just gonna say it, you know? And I played the right notes, but I also never lost sight of myself. I always made sure that I said what I felt like I had to say, but I still played the right notes. And they, you know, I think that was for a time and a place, and I think it was a choice I made. To kind of, like, I knew I wanted to go to MSM, and I knew the best chance I had was to get a full scholarship and go through that whole thing, and go through the motions of that. That's not to say I didn't gain a lot from it. I am where I am because of it. But, you know, I went through all that, and but I always made sure I was playing with my brother and playing with people who I felt like, you know, were really progressive amidst something that can feel very not progressive, and playing with your friends, you know, just for the sake of playing with your friends, not because it gets you somewhere. You guys know that. I don't need to tell you that, but, you know, I think it's worth saying, like, these things are, you know, sometimes you need to make hard decisions about what you're doing, and sometimes you do need to step your foot down one way or the other, depending on situation. But I think it's just key that you don't, that you always take care of your needs as well, and you make time for your needs.
Yeah, thank you.
No, of course. Are you thinking about your breathing when you're playing? How am I thinking about my breathing when you're playing? I don't know if I think about it a lot. I mean, I'm aware of it, but yeah, that's a tricky question to answer, just because I think it's so conditional, you know, and I think I'm aware of, like, you know, when I should stop playing to take a breath, you know. And I think that's, you know, I think I was talking to Ambrose once, and he said that trumpet playing, that as a trumpet player, it's really hard to improvise, you know, because you're always worried about playing the horn. And when he said that, it kind of it clarified things a lot for me. That, like, I think we want to sort of simultaneously work on sort of eliminating that barrier a little bit, but also definitely not lose sight of that sort of technical aspect of things, you know, and the necessity of that, you know. So yeah, to answer your question, I mean, you know, I definitely try and be aware of it, and when it doesn't feel right to keep playing, I'll stop and take a breath, that's for sure. But I also, you know, I like to push myself, and I like to really, you know, I was thinking about it recently, actually. Like, I was doing a long tone, and I was holding a note, and I think I held it for like 40 seconds or something like that. But I realized, like, there have been moments when I'm playing, and I'm like playing straight for almost like 50, you know, and barely taking a breath. So it's like, it really is hard to think about, because it's so conditional. So much depends on the moment. So much of it depends on what you're playing. And I think if you, you know, practice good breathing, then you don't have to think about it as much when you're improvising. It just kind of becomes second nature.
Cool. Well, we're at the 2 hour mark.
Wow.
This is the most I think this is maybe the most I've heard you talk in years.
Wow.
Yeah. Jeez. But man, a lot of incredible information and just thoughtfulness and really thoughtful things you're sharing with us, and very creative ways to approach, I think, problems that we all face as improvisers and questions we always ask ourselves. So I just want to say thank you for taking so much time and being so generous with who you are and what you have to offer with everyone.
Of course. Thank you for setting it up, and thanks to everybody who came, and also to those of you that made the venue change as well.
Yeah.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, sorry. We're going live with a bunch of people on a Zoom call has proved technically challenging. So, you know, we're going to do these classes, record it, and post them. But eventually we'll be back doing live. And eventually when we are able to do it live again, we hope to have Adam back. And yeah, so thank you, Adam. Thank you, everyone, for participating again. If you enjoyed this, please follow Afro Latin Jazz on all the social media. We have all sorts of great programming coming up. And again, I'll leave the chat open for a second for anyone else who wants to write their email address in the private chat to me. I'm writing them all down. If you've written it, I've already gotten it. And I'll make sure that we share a playlist and any other materials Adam mentioned in that email. So if you want that stuff, please write your emails down, and yeah,
stay in touch. And if you guys have any other thoughts, questions, you know, feel free to email me. Yeah.
Oh, I'll write Adam's email address down here for everyone, so that you all can have that in case you want to pick his brain anymore. Don't judge him for having an AOL.com email address.
Okay.
Cool.
Thanks, Zach.
Thank you, man. Good to see you and hear what you have to say. It's cool.
Yeah.
It's cool hearing it, because I play with you so much, and I know you're playing so well and for so long, yet we don't necessarily talk about it on this level that often. So it's cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, great to share with all of you guys. You guys